Marcy, say it.
We'll see. We used to take a lot of.
Well, I play.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
How's that sunshine feel, guys? Oh man, what a dreary week. And then God says, here you go. Here's your sunshine. You feel better now. Welcome to First Methodist Church of Bridgeport. We're just so glad that each and every one of you that are here, and we're glad for all of you that watch us on Facebook. We welcome everybody. If you'll just take out your bulletin, I have a couple of things. We have a new feature, so it's always, I love when this comes about, when just someone suggests something and it works out. So, you know, a lot of us have been longtime Methodists or members, and we know exactly what we're doing when we come here. But others who come here have not. And so someone asked why we bring the light into the sanctuary at the beginning of every service. So for a little while anyway, here down in the corner, I'm just going to tell you, why do we bring in the light and light the candles for the worship service? So the light of Christ is a visual reminder of the presence of God. Each worship service, we light the candles on the Lord's table to symbolize the presence of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. In the Bible, Jesus is often described as the light in the world. The book of Acts describes the Holy Spirit as tongues of fire. We bring in the light at the beginning of worship to remind us of God's presence. We follow the light out to remind us to follow the light out into the world. So there you go. And next week, I think it might have something to do with a robe. So we'll see. That question's been asked. You got a question, let the office know, and we will get you an answer and put it in our bulletin. So also in your bulletin on the back is some announcements that I want to talk about. First, I want to say giving statements are out here. It'll be the last Sunday that they're out here because tomorrow I have to mail if you haven't gotten yours. And also, there's a children's ministry meeting directly after church in the fellowship hall. So turn to the back and it says coming soon. Gals and Grace has their Galentine's Day party Monday, February 5th at 6. Please RSVP to the church by February 2nd. They will also be starting a women's Bible study on February 6th at 6 p.m. And you can go buy that book just about anywhere online. If you need help purchasing that book, please call the office and I will be glad to help you to do that. Lent is right around the corner. It starts early this year. And as a matter of fact, Ash Wednesday is on February 14th. Guys, there's no reason to make a reservation for dinner because we will have a church dinner here before Ash Wednesday service, okay? And there'll be more details about that coming soon. There will also be a Lent Bible study that begins on the 21st of February. It'll start at 5:30 and go through 7, and that'll be led by Pastor Rick. If you have a prayer request today, the yellow cards that you see on the back of the pew is where you put that and place it in the offering plate as it's passed. If you are a visitor, welcome, welcome, welcome. Please fill out the visitor card so that we can thank you even more. Now, if you'll, let's prepare our hearts and our minds at this time, for we are here to worship the Lord our God who made us and who blesses us every day. Take out your bulletin and we're going to do the call to worship. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Let us join in our praise and worship of God as we look forward to the new year. The Christmas season is over. This is the time of Epiphany, a time to remember that Christ has come to the world. All people are called into his love and grace.
Together we give thanks to God in our prayers, praise, and thanksgiving.
Christ has called the world. Wise men have heard and journeyed to pay him homage. Let us journey together to meet the Lord in all the days of our life. Amen.
Would you please bow your heads? Almighty and loving God, thank you for this time of worship. We ask for your blessing upon each of us. May our hearts be open to hear your voice. Guide us as a congregation and in our individual lives. Help us that we may seek to grow in your love and presence. In this time of Epiphany, we ask that your Holy Spirit guide each of us as we walk with Christ our Lord. Out of your wisdom and grace, may we follow Jesus into a renewed life. May we be empowered by your grace and love to live out your gospel this day and the year to come. In Christ's name we do pray. Amen. And I just want to ask you to stand as the light of Christ is brought into the sanctuary. Please invite him into your heart.
Good morning. If you would, please turn in your hymnal to hymn 62, All Creatures of Our God and King. And this morning we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Thank you. ushers come forward to receive our tithes and our offering. As we worship, as we bring ourselves, our heart, our mind, our soul to the Lord, we also bring our gifts as a way of saying thanks and a part of our worship. And so, let us go to the Lord and ask for a blessing upon this. Almighty and Holy God, we thank you, dear Lord, for the goodness you pour out on each and every one of us. We ask you, dear Lord, that as we seek to give thanks, that this portion which we return to you, that you will bless it in your will, bless it in your way, bless it to be used for your kingdom. In Christ we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
How y'all doing?
Good.
Yeah. Don't you feel energetic?
Yeah.
I mean, after that song. Nicole, have you been hanging out in New Orleans or something? Oh, God, that was great. Well, it's a joy to be here and continue in our worship as we have the opportunity. And I know I say this a lot, because I think it's important that we realize that prayer and prayer together, we don't just rope through it. And it's an opportunity to talk to God and to talk to God as a group. And throughout the scriptures, we are reminded to go to the Lord. And James comes to mind, I think, for a lot of us, and reminded us to come and to pray for one another, to pray for the sick, do right by each other. And part of that is in the prayers that we lift up. And what a joy that is. And that in itself is a joy. That in the presence of God and the opportunity we have to lift up our heart, mind, and soul together to Jesus Christ. In our prayer concerns, you'll find them listed in your bulletin on the back. And as always, I suggest maybe you put it on the refrigerator. That's probably... Does anybody really put anything on the refrigerator anymore? We would, but someone covered it up with magnets.
So you can put the prayer request up there, huh?
Yes. And our joy is making all things new. God is making all things new. And that's on an individual basis and on a world base. And sometimes we have to look really close. But the Lord is present. The Lord is making a difference. And He's making it in us and through us. Do we have some other joys we'd like to lift up? Yes, sir.
I have a friend out of Parker County. His name is Sonny. His wife's name is Jody. She's been fighting lupus for a few years, and now they have just found out that she has cancer as well. And they're got her in hepatitis.
Yeah.
And they're running 14 days of chemo. She has to be there the entire time.
Okay.
So it's Sonny and Jody Black.
Okay. And Kelly, would you write that down on the card? And then just on the way out the door.
Hand that to his wife.
What?
Hand it to me.
Oh. That's a joke of my confidence, isn't it?
That's in fact.
Guys, you ever notice women stick together? And we don't. We can't even get a Bible study together. We need to work on that. Are there any other joys or concerns? Or?
Rick?
Sorry.
Marcia and I have lost a dear friend Friday. Sorry. Friday Robert, 90 years old. He's a good friend of ours in the senior center of Decatur. And he passed away peacefully Friday morning.
I'm sorry. Known for quite a while. What's his name?
I've known him for about 8 years. What's his name? Ernie Roberts.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry to hear about that. Our friends are really part of our life.
Yep.
Very good. We are one another.
Mark.
Yes?
Hi, Rick. I just want to look up our daughter Dana. She's with MS, but also there's other issues with the mental issues that stay home with her today. So things are really not going well. So lift up Dana.
Sure will. Yeah, Dana, Dan is constantly fighting a disease that is very difficult. And so let us keep her in our prayers, and as well as her family. Now let us go to the Lord, our God, in prayer. Almighty and holy God, we praise and give thanks for the opportunity to be here together, to meet with, by the Spirit, all of your people across the world. We thank you for those who are with us by electronics. We know that by your Spirit, by the power of your Spirit, we worship together. We ask you, O Lord, that you will hear our thanks. We give thanks to you for the forgiveness of our sins, for the way in which we separate ourselves from you. We ask you, O Lord, that your peace and power will be on us, lead us, guide us individually and as a church, your church. We lift up those upon our prayer list, those who we've mentioned in name, and those within our hearts and minds. Dear Lord, we ask that you'll put your hands upon them, that your peace, your healing, your love will be known to them. We ask you, O Lord, that you will be with this nation. Be with this nation in which we teach every one of us, the words that we speak to one another, the way in which we conduct ourselves. Here we are. May your Spirit truly be our leader. We pray this for all nations. And dear Lord, in the midst of this, we realize that we are, as people, as species, that we have fallen very short of your dreams for us, your desires for us, the life to live. Therefore, there's much violence and discourse. So we give thanks to those who are willing to stand between us and violence. We serve on our streets, protect us from ourselves. We serve around the globe. Dear Lord, we lift them up. May your peace be upon them, their families. We pray for those who come to us in times of need, in times of disease or accidents, and those who care for us in health care, those who care for our children in all aspects. We give thanks and we ask your blessing upon them, as we ask that you will bless us that we will truly be your hands and your feet in your world. Hear us, O Lord, as we lift up the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory children in Children's Church.
be heard. In the meditations of our hearts, may your word be known. And in the faithfulness of our lives, may your word be shown.
Today's reading is 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1 through 13. Now, concerning food sacrificed to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge, but anyone who loves God is known by him. Hence, as to eating of food offered to idols, we know that no idol in the world really exists, and that there is no God but one. Indeed, even though there are many so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as in the fact there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, for whom are all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. It is not everyone, however, who has this knowledge. Since some have become so accustomed to idols until now, they still think of the food they eat as the food offered to an idol, and in their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not bring us close to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if others see you, who possesses knowledge, eating in the temple of an idol? Might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols? So by your knowledge, the weak brother or sister from whom Christ died is destroyed. But when you thus sin against brothers and sisters and wound their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food is the cause of their falling, I will never again eat meat, so that I may not cause one of them to fall. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So thank you very much for that reading. Our scripture today is what we call 1 Corinthians. It's a letter. It's a letter that Paul has written, the Apostle Paul, has written to a church in Corinth. He's put a lot of time in Corinth. But it turns out that Corinth is a very vibrant city. It's a port city. It's a lot of different cultures and religions are being washed through, if you will, this small area. And so even though he spent a lot of time there trying to teach the little church about what it is to follow Christ, to love Christ, to see what the gospel brings us, to find a new life in Jesus, he finds himself having to write back several times to this church in Corinth because there is competing ideas. It's in the 20th century or the 21st century. This is the first century. And even though we think of Christ as common knowledge, and there's few people, believers or not, that have heard something. Because this was the time when it was all beginning to bloom. That it was just taking off. Like a seed in the ground, the roots are, those little fine roots are just starting to come out and seek the water and the nourishment to grow this plant, which is the Church of Jesus Christ, which we are part of. What comes forth from this seed that has been planted, and Paul is very concerned and when he writes, sometimes he writes in ways that irritate me. But they did have a different way
you know, saying things and looking at things, and even like calling people who are new in the faith little children. Well, that wouldn't probably be a great evangelistic tool these days. Oh, you little children, don't you follow me, and I'll show you who to follow, or whatever. Jesus, when he was with his disciples and he was teaching, he used the same term, little children, because children were someone who had no rights, had no real authority, had no power within anywhere in the Mediterranean. And he tells the disciples who are trying to keep these little children from coming up to him and being blessed. And he uses that opportunity to talk about all of the little children in the faith, which maybe we all are still quite a bit in that category. Because we are talking about learning about God. And learning about God, not in the way that I might have studied for a history exam or something like that, but in a way that we learn deep within our heart, within our spirit. Jesus tells his disciples, it is better if you were to take a millstone, huge, ridiculously sized, tie it around your waist and throw yourself in the water, than to make one of these little ones falter in the faith. Now that's a lot of my words that are in there. Jesus was much more eloquent. That seems rather drastic. But it also shows how easy it is to get someone off track, to instead of being part of God's solution, we can become part of the problem that stands in the way of people in their Christian development, or whether or not they'll even give it a thought. Now we go up to Paul and his time, and we see the same thing is going on. And in some ways, he uses a lot of the same language. Even though you know, he tells some of the Corinthians, even though you have knowledge, and this is a Greek society, they love knowledge. In fact, the Gnostics were Neoplatonists, new followers of Plato, and it was all about the knowledge you could acquire. And so, you know, instead of being here in church and talking openly about Christ and reading the scriptures together and expressing the experiences we've had with God together and our hopes and what happens for us in the presence of God, it was a big secret if you're a Gnostic. It's kind of like, I know something you don't know, you know? That kind of thing. You ever have someone come up and say, hey, I know a secret. Oh, really? What? Oh, I can't tell you it's a secret. But that is very much a part of the society that they're in. And when Paul's speaking about knowledge, he's flirting with that whole Gnostic system as a counter to it. And just the way in which the Greek mind thought in that period. It's all about the knowledge that you acquire. That way you get to elevate yourself. You get to elevate yourself. We get to elevate ourselves. No, we don't. And Paul makes it clear, the only way you're going to elevate yourself is in your humility. It's not about the one who thinks they know, not have knowledge. In fact, he even says, well, if you think you know it, then that's just as proof you don't. We're talking about Almighty God. If we think we've got God's circle ready to mend, stamped with our approval, then we're the ones who don't know. And we could be a danger of misleading people. Because it is a whole lot to bring to the table. A whole lot of life. In the title of the sermon about the feast, God's feast, And Jesus constantly talks about, or has quite a few stories about a great banquet, a feast that God is providing for us. And there is a feast now, and there is the great feast. The great feast after death and to life and resurrection. And we're all invited to it. The entire world is actually invited. It's whether or not we accept or not. And God looks at his people and very much like that story that Jesus was talking about, the king who threw a feast, a wedding feast for his son, and people didn't want to come, and told his servants, which is us, go back out and grab some people and get them in here. They didn't say grab them. But make that invitation out to each and every one. Because I want my feast hall filled. God is in the salvation business, not in the keeping away business. But there are things in which we need to remember that there is moral actions and thoughts that simply take us away from Christ, take us away from God. Where there's moral actions and thoughts that literally harm one another. And to harm another, well, it's hard to make that line up with the great commandment, isn't it? To love the Lord your God, all your heart, mind, your strength. To love your neighbor as yourself. I'm going through quite a bit of material as really, really what seems to be a simple, very easy to read scripture. Most things, when it comes to the really deep, important parts of life, when it comes to God, never be afraid to pull back a new layer to find out something new and to grow. To grow by the power of the Spirit and grow by the reading of the words. Let God do the growing that we may truly be part of what God is doing in this world. And this is exactly where Paul is at when he's writing to the Corinthians. Because some of them are filled with knowledge, but they seem to not be filled with love. And as we read through, we find out that without the love of God, there is no knowledge. Yes, we can have the knowledge to do whatever we want to do in our electronics, in our space program. You know, that's pretty wild. Mathematics and physics or whatever, that human one knowledge. But there's something else. And it's a little more difficult to explain. But it can be shown. It can be demonstrated. And it can be lived out. This knowledge of God. And I love the way that Paul writes, and, you know, it says, you love God and God will know you. It doesn't even say, you know, you love God, and then you're going to know God. God will know you. That alone is enough to chew on, isn't it? Does anyone want to give a definition of that? I want to use a little demonstration, if you will. It's one that obviously I've made up. So, you know, don't blame anyone else for this. But let's say there's three Christians in Corinth. Gaius, Titus, Romulus. And they're walking along and they're talking because this letter from Paul has just come in, if you will. And it's been read in some of the house churches, and they're wondering about that. And none of them really agree. And Gaius is the newest. He has only recently found Christ. And he's having a hard time because he's living in one of the most pagan cities, one of the most bustling pagan cities, a city where to do business, you do it much, it's much easier to do business if you go to the temples, if you worship the same gods. And putting yourself aside in Christianity is not good for business. It makes it more difficult. Not impossible, but it does make it more difficult. And if you want to buy meat, the meat that's for sale in the market, everybody pretty well knows where it comes from. It comes from a sacrifice at a temple, whether it's Mars, Jupiter, or, Aphrodite, whatever. It comes from a place that God's been warning the Israelites about from the beginning. Don't participate in idol worship. Now, I don't think we've got a big problem with people going to pagan institutions and worshiping. But it doesn't mean we don't have idols in our lives. It doesn't mean we don't have idols that matter more to us, even though we don't like to admit it, than our relationship with God. So yeah, this is relevant. This is a real conversation for us to have over and over and over again. Not to beat it to death and not to beat ourselves to death, but try to find out the difference between what is freedom in Christ and what is duty in Christ. Love the Lord your God. Love your neighbor. So my three guys, Gaius and Titus and Romulus are walking along. Gaius is doing, and he's saying, I don't know. I don't know how in the world you can have a God that doesn't have a big temple. How in the world do we have a God that we don't make physical sacrifices to? That we don't take a lamb or whatever it is and have a sacrifice to eat. He's still trying to figure out what it is. How do you worship this Christ? It's a completely new idea. And it's a completely new idea for a lot of people in our world, including our friends and neighbors. How do you worship this Christ? Where is your temple? Where is the sacrifice meat that everybody else does? And he's completely convinced, Guy says, that if he participates in anything to do with the temple, that he is sinning against God, and he's afraid God will forsake him. He's weak. His faith is fragile. Well, Titus is a pretty good of a guy, but he really doesn't care. Because he's heard the message and he understands, and no longer does he have to worry about eating meat from the temple or anything that's been sacrificed to the gods that we've made. So he's walking along as they're having this conversation, eating a big old piece of lamb, nice roasted lamb. I'm not a lamb fan, but I bet I would be if I lived in Corinth. So he's just eating away and saying, man, guys, you got it wrong. You don't have to worry about it. And he says, the truth, Christ is our salvation. And we can't eat what we want to eat. But remember, love the Lord your God. And love your neighbor as yourself. And so what is Titus doing to Gaius, my made up people? As he's eating this wonderfully smelling food, this meat that Gaius hadn't been able to eat since he became a Christian, and he's telling him, it's okay, go eat it. The problem is, when Gaius eats it, he will truly believe that he is breaking the will and the love of God. And that should matter to Titus. But it doesn't. And the third guy, Romulus, he looks over there at Titus and says, what are you doing to him? Don't you see you're confusing him? Don't you see you're really getting in the way of his growth? As we're heading towards the synagogue, we're heading towards the house church, and you're over here tempting him and totally confusing him. He says, I don't know, it doesn't matter. I have the brain knowledge. I can't help it if you didn't know any better. In fact, I'm going to say, I'm not going to go with you guys. I'm going to go to a meeting of Gnostics down the road. And guys is saying about it, he says, I'm sorry. I'm going back to that temple because that land looks really good. And for him, that is falling off the wagon. For him, it's like any of us in today's society who are imprisoned by alcohol and working to be sober, proud to have that chip, and going to them and saying, hey, I know this, I know scotch is your favorite drink. How about have a drink with me? Come on. You're inviting to harm them. Now, these are just examples, very broad, not being confined to just this. But Titus is missing a huge point. And that is that Gaius is part of who he is in the body of Christ. That Gaius is important to him, even if he doesn't like Gaius, because they have been called together in the body of Christ. And even if he never knew Gaius, he knows at that point that this is dangerous for his spiritual journey. So come on, Titus. Have a heart. Remember who you serve. Not Gaius, but Jesus Christ. And by the thinking and the theology and the words of Paul, we are all part of the body of Jesus Christ. Yes, we do have a duty to one another. To walk with one another, to be spiritual mentors with one another, to hear one another. Nothing helps me grow more than at this point when I hear stories from you guys, from other people. And two things happen for you. They find out you're a pastor and they don't know you. One, they get real quiet and try to get away as fast as possible. But the other is, they want to tell you exactly how to believe and want you to know it. Which I'm fine with that. Because I've heard some diamonds. Beautiful stories of salvation and life and love of Christ from places I never would have thought of. Because someone took the time to share it with me. And it's interesting. It's usually when I need to hear it. Has anyone else ever noticed that when you can be kind of low in your spirit, it's like God sends a message to one of y'all through a beloved or through a stranger. It reminds you of why you have that peace of God and who God is to you. We don't want to mess this up with the guys or anyone else who is looking to become part of this worldwide body of Jesus Christ. Because we know that Christ cares equally for all. And we have not earned our way into a better seat. When I stand before Christ, I don't think he's going to be impressed with my seminary degree. Maybe some classes over another one that he did pretty good here. He really messed up there. But it's the love of the heart for God and for one another. Romulus, my friend Romulus, he knows this. He tries to explain it. He tries to remind Titus about the Jesus story with the millstone around your waist. And it's, you know, basically Gaius is one of those little children and you just ran him off. Scriptures are filled with filled with stories of who we're supposed to be. As we walk in this life into the world, so the world can see the love of God in you and in me. Reflect. Reflect. Eat that lamb bone by yourself. But reflect the love of God. This morning, God, I was looking at the book, and it's waning, so it's getting a little bit smaller. It's not quite the full moon it was. But when you look up, it's so bright. You can just see everything, can't you? On a really good, bright full moon, you can see the path. You can go hiking by one. And I look up, and what draws me is the imperfections of the moon. It's filled with craters. It's filled with pot marks. It's filled with what has happened during its time. During its life, if you'll let me say that. During the life of the moon, it's been hit with multiple asteroids and comets, and it's been beat up. And we used to even look up there, and ancient people look up there and go, oh, there's this great ocean up there. And we had all the imagination, we went wild with all the possibilities of what the moon was. We even saw a face in the moon. You're the man in the moon, right? If the moon, if we can find an image of ourselves in the moon, in all its faults, if you will, in all its beams, and yet it still reflects the light of the sun. The moon does not have its own light. And my friends, we do not have our own light. We have something better. We have the light of Jesus Christ. And God has called you to reflect it to the best that you can. And I can hear a thousand choruses of people saying, I'm not good enough. You don't know what I've done. You don't know where I've been. The moon is filled with the marks of its life. But actually, that's the part that captures the imagination. People begin to find their own image. People can identify with you. And if they identify with you, then they can identify with your walk and your love for Christ. They're not hearing about it just from some preacher. They're not hearing about this great, beautiful gift from someplace vague. They're hearing about it from your life. Don't lie about the lamb bone. But you don't have to eat it right in front of them. Do what we can for one another. We are all different. But we have our great love for Christ. And He is calling us to share this love of Christ. Because everything depends on it. For us, for the world. Praise be to God. For you, me, we are all. Love of the Lord our God. Amen. And as we sing our closing hymn, this is how we'd like to join the congregation. Our congregation, we joyfully invite you to come forward. Please write down some information on a card before we bring it up. As we know, my memory is not so good.
Would please stand and turn in the page we sing to number 2244, People Need the Lord.
Thank you.
watching Dale, and I noticed the scene of Epiphany on the front of the altar there. And I want to remind everybody, it's still Epiphany. So it's still the time of discovery. Discovering who we are and who Christ is. And as we follow this light, as Tracy said, the symbol of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, out into the world. And that light is in you, the real light. But it is calling out. Let us follow. Well, let us take this prayer. We give thanks to you, O God, for this time together. We thank you for one another. We thank you that we can be your church. And we ask you, Lord, that you will lead us and guide us. For only by your leadership and your guidance will we truly be the church of Jesus Christ. Amen.